Welcome. In this tutorial, we'll try to answer two main questions. Firstly, which microRNAs are regulated in response to brassino steroids? And secondly, which genes are potential targets of brassino steroid-induced microRNAs? Brassino steroids are a group of plant hormone essential for growth and development, as well as for coping with biotic and biotic stress. Structurally, are polydeoxylated sterol derivatives with great similarity to animal hormones. Multiple studies suggest the great biotechnological potential of this group of compounds, not only for their ability to mitigate the negative effects of biotic and biotic stress, but also for their potential on the improvement of plant growth and crop yields. MacroRNA precursors are synthesized in the nucleus by the RNA polymerase II. Unlike in animals, their preprocessing also takes place inside this organelle. The transcripts, after being processed by different enzymes, are methylated and incorporated into the RISC complex. Finally, this complex is exported to the cytoplasm, where the RNA-induced gene silencing process takes place. Four main factors justify why the microRNA are considered master regulators. First, a large number of microRNAs are regulated in response to environmental conditions. Second, computational prediction estimates that each microRNA regulates hundreds of genes. Third, most plant microRNAs regulate transcription factors. And finally, the targets include not only coding genes, but also non-coding RNAs. In this tutorial, inspired by a paper by Parker et al., we'll analyze the interplay between brassino steroids and the microRNA-mediated silencing pathway, considered one of the most versatile regulatory mechanisms in plants. The training is structured in two parts. In the first part, we'll analyze the expression of microRNAs, starting from reads obtained in two different conditions, controlled and brassino steroid treatment. In the next step, we'll perform the quality assessment by using different tools. Then, we'll quantify the transcript by using miRDIP2. And finally, we'll perform the differential expression analysis using DESEC2. In the second part, we'll analyze the expression of total mRNAs from reads obtained under similar experimental conditions. Similarly, we'll first analyze the quality of the sequence. Then, we'll quantify them by using Salmon Quant, and after that, we'll perform a differential expression analysis by using DESEC2. Finally, we'll use the Target Finder tool to identify potential targets for microRNAs induced by brassino steroids. In this training, we'll use three groups of datasets: microRNA reads, mRNA reads, and different datasets. The microRNA datasets consist of six FASTQ files obtained by using the Illumina GAX2 sequencing platform. The plant samples were obtained from wild-type WS2 seedlings treated with MOG or 1 micromolar epibrassinolide for 90 minutes before harvest. On the other hand, the mRNA datasets consist of four FASTQ files generated through the Illumina HiSeq 2000 sequencing system. The plant samples were obtained from wild-type Columbia seedlings. Finally, we'll use two additional datasets, a reference Gravidopsis transcriptome and the PREM database, which includes more than 20,000 annotated microRNA sequences. First, we should download the reads from Zenodo and organize them into collections. Then, we are going to copy the data table. Next, we should select Upload Data, then click on the Rule Basic tab, select Unload Data as Collection, paste the data table, and click on Build. Next, we are going to specify the type of data for each column. To do this, click on Rules, add modify column definition, and add the definition for each column.
The column A corresponds to the identifiers. The column B corresponds to the names of the collections. The third column corresponds to the address of the file hosted in Zenodo, and the column D are the data types. Now we should select Apply and Upload. In this way, we'll obtain our reads organized according to their data type and the experimental conditions. With this, we have imported all the RNA-seq reads necessary for the analysis. Next, we are going to add the tags, which will allow us to easily identify the samples through the process. Let's click the tag icon, and we are going to use BR tag and mRNA tag. Then select the control mRNA sample and add the tags. Now we should do the same with the brassinosteroid steroid treated microRNA dataset. And finally, we are going to add the tags to the control microRNA dataset. Perfect. Now we can assign a name to row history, for example, Arabidopsis transcriptome analysis. Next, we are going to import the rest of the datasets. In order to achieve that, we are going to copy the table again, select Upload Data. Now we should replace the previous table with the one we just copied, select Upload Data as dataset, and click Build. Again, we must identify each column. Okay, the first column corresponds to the name, the second column to the address in Zenodo. Finally, we should click on Apply and Upload. Okay, let's continue. As indicated above, for this training, we are going to use a subset of the original samples,
in order to reduce the time needed to perform the analysis.
To be more precise, we are going to use 1% of the total reads, randomly selected. Once we have obtained the necessary datasets, we can start with the analysis. First, we are going to carry out the quality assessment of the microRNA sequence. This is a very important step, since the sequencing process is a source of errors, which, if not identified, can lead to inconsistent results. It's also important to evaluate the presence of adapters, which can also interfere with the subsequent analysis. We'll start with FATQC. Click on the tool, then select the collection corresponding to the control microRNAs, and click on Run. Now we are going to repeat the same procedure with the brassinosteroid treated samples. In the meantime, let's rename the dataset. Although it's not absolutely essential, it can help us to avoid confusions. Now, we are going to rename the datasets of the brassinosteroid treated samples. The next step is to combine the dataset generated by FATQC for each of the treatments. This is necessary in order to be able to visualize the whole set of samples using MultiQC. We should select the corresponding raw dataset generated by FATQC for each of the treatments and click Execute. Finally, we are going to use MultiQC to generate the quality reports. We should click on the MultiQC button, select the tool with which we have generated the data, in this case FastQC, and select the collection that we have just generated. We can assign a name to our report, for example, microRNA and processed QC. And click on Execute. Next, we are going to visualize the report generated by MultiQC. You should click on the I next to the web page generated by this tool. First, we are going to display the statistics for the percentage of duplicated reads. As we can see, around 70% of the reads correspond to duplication. The following plot shows the average FRET score of our reads in different positions. All of them show acceptable values, about 30. This other plot shows the relationship between the number of reads and their average quality. In the case of the GC content, we can see that 3 of the datasets have value far from the value considered acceptable, which could interfere in the subsequent analysis. The duplication percentage are relatively high. Finally, in the case of the darker content, we can observe that the values are above the acceptable limits. All samples include Illumina small RNA adapters in more than 40% of the reads. With this information, we can now answer the first question. Is it necessary to trim the reads? To remove the adapter sequence, we'll use the TrimColor tool, a CatAdapt wrapper. So, click on the tool, select the collection corresponding to the microRNA control samples, select Illumina small RNA adapters, and finally execute. Then, repeat the procedure with the brassinosteroid treated samples. In the meantime, we'll rename the TrimColor generated datasets. Then first, let's go to rename the control samples. Click here and we should paste. And now we are going to rename the treated samples. Just replace control by via perfect. Once the samples have been processed by Dringalore, we'll reevaluate the quality of the samples in order to confirm that the quality parameters have improved after processing them. To do this, we are going to repeat the same procedure as before. Click on FastQC, select Processed Control Samples, and execute. Now, repeat the procedure with the brassinosteroid treated samples. In the meantime, we'll assign appropriate name to the datasets. As noted before, it's not absolutely necessary to rename the samples, but it might avoid future confusions. Next, we are going to use the Merge Collection tool again to combine the results generated by FastQC. Remember to select the raw data files. Finally, we are going to use MultiQC to generate a quality report of our sample from the statistics obtained by FastQC. Select the collection we have just generated, and once again, it's advisable to give the report a title, so it can be properly identified. For example, brassinosteroid processed QC, and click Execute. Although the evaluation of the quality of the samples is a tedious process, it's an indispensable step to prevent the inclusion of defective reads which could interfere in the subsequent analysis. Next, we are going to check the quality parameters of our samples before and after processing them with Dringalore, using the Scratput feature. Let's compare the quality parameters of the reads. As we can see, the percentage of duplicated reads having been reduced after processing them. One factor that could explain this is the existence of highly conserved motif. In the case of the quality of the sequence, in both cases the patterns are similar. One of the parameters that show clear differences after processing is the GC content. As you can see, it has improved in most of the datasets. In the case of the read lengths, we can also see clear differences. The original samples have a homogeneous length of 35 base pairs, whereas after processing them with Dringalore, as a result of the removal of the adapter sequence, reads of different lengths appear. Finally, we can see that in the processed samples, adapter contamination is insignificant, with values below 0.1%. We have previously discussed some of the factors that might determine the high number of duplicated sequences. In addition to the possible existence of highly conserved motifs, this could also be explained by different causes, such as the existence of overrepresented sequence or contamination with foreign sequence. Once we have assessed the quality of our reads, the next step is to quantify them. For this, we'll use two different tools, MirDeep to Mapper and MirDeep to Quantifier. With MirDeep to Mapper, we are going to group the reads with identical sequence. The quantification will be carried out by MirDeep to Quantifier. This takes place in two steps. Firstly, the predefined mature microRNA sequence are mapped to the predefined precursors. And secondly, the reads are mapped to the precursors. Click on MirDeep to Mapper. Then select the control processed reads. Enable the deletion of reads with no standard nucleotides. And in the collapse reads or map option, select collapse. And then execute. Then we will repeat the same procedure with the samples treated with prasinostheroids steroids. Select once again MirDeep to Mapper. Now select the prasinostheroid microRNA treated dataset. Enable the remove read with no standard nucleotide option. Select collapse and execute. While the process finishes, we are going to rename the generated files. Now, we are going to carry out the quantification of microRNAs using MirDeep to Quantifier. This tool requires, in addition to the collapse read obtained in the previous step, three additional FASTA files: the precursor sequence, the mature microRNA sequence, and the start sequence. Then, let's select first the collection of the control microRNAs. Select the mature microRNA sequence. Now select the start microRNA seq FASTA file. We can unset this option and execute. Now we are going to repeat the procedure with the collapsed read corresponding to the brassinosteroid treated samples. Let's rename the files. Now, let's take a look at the collapsed read generated by MIRDIP to Mapper. As we can see, to each sequence, this tool assigns an identifier, followed by a value indicating the number of times it appears in our reads. Before moving to the differential expression analysis, we need to make some modifications in the result generated by MIRDIP to quantifier. In particular, we need to extract the first two columns. But first, let's examine the content of the file generated by MIRDIP to quantifier. The first column corresponds to the identifiers of the major microRNAs. The second column contains the number of times each sequence appears. The remaining columns contain additional information, including the identifiers of the precursor sequence and normalized quantification values. In our case, we'll only use the data included in the first two columns. So, we are going to select the cat column from a table tool, select the raw data file corresponding to the control sample, and execute. Once again, we should repeat the procedure with the brassinosteroid treated samples. While the process is running, we'll rename the generated datasets. Now, we can carry out the differential expression analysis by using DSEC2. DSEC2 is a popular tool for genome-level differential expression analysis. It uses the negative phenomial distribution, employing a slightly more stringent approach compared to other methods, yet having a good balance between sensitivity and specificity, reducing both false positives and false negatives. Then, select DSEC2. Now we should specify a factor name, for example, effect brassinosteroids. Now specify the first factor name, for example, brassinosteroids. Now we should select the brassinosteroid treated microRNA counts. Specify the second factor name, control. Select the control microRNA counts. Now, we should disable the files have a header option, and the rest of the options are fine. It's not necessary to modify them, and execute. Perfect. It's running. Now, we are going to rename the generated datasets. Let's rename the result dataset. And now the plot file. Okay, let's back. As we have seen, DSEC2 generates two outputs, a table with the normalized counts and a graphical summary of the results. First, we are going to inspect the quantification table. As we can see, it includes 7 columns. The gene IDs, the mean expression, log ratio, standard error, world stats, p-value, and p-adjust value. In our case, we are going to use the p-adjusted value and the log ratio. Next, we'll inspect the graphical summary. The principal component analysis plot provides useful information to evaluate the similarity of our samples. The distribution of the samples suggests that there's not so much difference between both treatments. The heat map of sample-to-sample distance gives us similar information over the similarities and dissimilarities between our samples. Finally, the MA plot shows the log-to-fold change assignable to a given variable over the mean of normalized counts. Next, we'll proceed to extract those genes whose differential expression is statistically significant by selecting those genes whose adjusted p-value is less than 0.05. We'll use the p-adjusted value because it allows us to take in account the false discovery rate. Applying the false discovery rate becomes necessary when we are measuring thousands of variables. We are going to use the filter data on any column tool. Now we should select the file generated by DSEC2. We should set the condition column 7 less than 0.05 and execute. Now we can answer the proposed question. How many microRNAs show significant differential expression? Let's have a look at the results. Unfortunately, we haven't identified any gene. The reason is that the subsample dataset doesn't have sufficient read depth. In order to get a significant result, we are going to import the DSEC2 analysis result generated from the whole dataset. Then, let's copy the Zenodo link, click in Upload Data, click in Paste Fetch Data, paste the URL, and start. Now we are going to rename the dataset and add all the microRNA related tags. Let's copy the proposed name. Now we can paste it in this field and save. Yeah, we can see we have 442 genes. Now we are going to add the tags microRNA, Brazilian steroid, and control. Like expand and add the tags microRNA, control. And Brazilian steroid. Okay. Now let's repeat the filtering process with the new dataset. In that case, we'll start filtering those genes with significant expression. Then we'll get the upregulated genes whose log rate is higher than 0. As we explained it before, in the first step, we'll use the p-adjusted value, lower than 0.05. And then we filter those whose law ratio is higher than 0. And then we'll sort the result. Okay, then set the condition, colon 7, lower than 0.05, and execute. Now we are going to get the upregulated genes. Set the condition, colon 3 higher than 0. Execute. And finally, we are going to sort the result. We should select the colon 3, descending order, and execute. Okay, now we are going to rename the new datasets. Perfect. First of all, let's check if in this case we have got any gene whose differential expression is significant. Now we can respond the questions. In this case, we have got 39 differentially expressed genes. Now let's answer the second question. How many microRNAs show statistical significant upregulation? And what's the most upregulated microRNA? In that case, we have identified 16 upregulated genes. And the most upregulated is MIR-150CG. Here we can see the log ratio and the p-adjusted value. This concludes the first part of the analysis. To recapitulate, we started from microRNA raw reads, on which we performed a quality assessment. Then we quantified them, and finally, we performed a differential expression analysis in order to identify the upregulated microRNAs. In the second part, we start with raw mRNA reads, then we'll perform a quality assessment, we'll quantify them with Salmon, and we'll use DSEC2 in order to identify non-regulated mRNAs. Then, let's start with the second part of the analysis. The procedure to carry out the quality assessment of the mRNAs is similar to the one followed in the first part. We'll start with the FastQC tool, select Control mRNA collection, and execute. Then, repeat the procedure with the brassinosteroid-treated samples. Next, we are going to rename the datasets generated by FastQC.
Now let's merge the files. Select the Brazilian asteroid and the control raw data files and execute. Finally, we can use MultiQC in order to generate the quality report. Select FastQC, select the merged dataset. Now provide a title to the report, for example, mRNA QC report, and execute. Now we just need to wait until the report is generated. It's done. Plotting the quality metrics of the different samples and comparing them using MultiQC can help us to detect potential problems. This is essential because if we start with poor quality data, the obtained result won't have any relevance from a biological point of view. As we can see, after using a tool, Galaxy suggests us potential useful tools for the subsequent analysis step. Those recommendations are based on prediction obtained by machine learning from other users' data. Now, let's have a look at the report generated by MultiQC. In this case, as we can see, the duplicated reads are below 5% of the total, a very acceptable value. The quality of the samples are also above 30, which indicates that the reads are of good quality. The GC content is perfect. There's no overrepresented reads at all. Finally, we can see that the adapter content is also very low in all the samples, being found in less than 2% of the reads in all cases. With this information, we can answer the question: are there any stats that indicate the need to process the samples? Although some of the samples have adapters, we'll move directly to the quantification. In the following section, we explain the reason. To carry out the quantification, we'll use the Salmon Quant tool. One of the characteristics of Salmon is that it doesn't require performing base-to-base alignment. Salmon relies on the quasi-mapping concept, a new mapping technique that allows the rapid and accurate mapping of RNA stack reads. After determining the best mapping for each read, Salmon generates the final transcript abundance estimation after modeling sample-specific parameters and bias. If you are interested in additional details about the Salmon algorithm, I recommend you to have a look at this information blog. Then, let's start with the quantification. We should click the Salmon Quant. Now we should select the transcriptome FASTA file. Next, we should select the control mRNA collection and enable the validate mappings. Now we should select the annotation file. And execute. This section explains why it's not necessary to process the reads when using Salmon Quant. This is because if the comers of the reads are not in the hash table, they are not taken in account. Now, let's rename the datasets generated by Salmon. We are going to repeat the previous step, selecting, in this case, the collection corresponding to the brazen asteroid treated samples. Now, we'll assign the appropriate names to the generated dataset. Salmon generates two outputs for each sample, the quantification per transcript and a gene quantification dataset. Each output consists of a tabular dataset with 5 columns, the name, target transcript length, the computed effective length, the relative abundance of the transcript in unit of transcript per million, and the estimation of the number of reads mapping to each transcript. Now, we can respond to this question. Could you explain why did we not trim the reed before? The reason is that since the camel which contain the adapter sequence are not present in the transcriptome, from which the hash table have been generated, they are omitted. Let's have a look at the dataset generated by Salmon. The first column includes the gene IDs, then the length and the effective length. As we can appreciate, both length differs. The reason is that the effective length takes into account all the factors that can affect the probability of sampling fragments. Then we find the TPN and the estimated number of reads. Here we can see the total numbers of gene quantified. Next, we are going to perform the differential expression analysis using DSEC2, the same tool we used in the first part of the analysis. Then, let's select the tool. Now we should specify a factor name, for example, brazen asteroid treatment. Now we should specify the first factor, brazen asteroid, select the gene quantification generated by Salmon. Now we specify the second factor, control. Next, select the quantification of the control samples. Now we should leave this opt-in. The choice of input data, we should select TPM values, select Salmon, select the annotation. And just execute. Again, Galaxy suggests us different tools for the next step of the analysis. Okay, now let's rename the generated datasets. We're going to copy the proposed name. Just click here and paste. And save. Okay. Now we are going to analyze the Salmon outputs. Let's have a look at the result generated by the SEC2. Here we can see, as before, gene ID, mean expression, and the p-adjusted value. Now, let's compare the similarity between the mRNA samples and the microRNA ones, for which we'll use the scratchbook feature. As we can see, the effect of the brazenose steroid treatment is more prominent in the case of the mRNA samples than in the macroRNA ones. The heat map of sample-to-sample distance reflects a similar trend, with the mRNA sample of each treatment clustered together. Now we can respond to this question. Here is the solution. Now, as we did before, we are going to import the DSEC result generated from the full mRNA dataset. Then, let's copy this another link, clicking Upload Data, now paste, and start. Okay, now let's rename the new dataset. And paste and save. Perfect. Now we are going to add some tags, mRNA, control, and brazenose steroid. As we can see, the differential expression analysis includes more than 80,000 genes. The next step is to extract those genes whose expression is statistically significant. Then, let's click in the tool, select the condition, column 7 less than 0.05, and execute. Okay, now we are going to rename the dataset. And save. Perfect. Now we are going to filter the upregulated genes. Column 3 higher than 1. Now let's rename again the dataset, and finally we are going to get the genes which are down-regulated, column 3 less than minus 1, and let's rename the dataset, down-regulated mRNAs. Okay. Now we can respond to the questions. First, how many genes shows statistical significant differential expression? The second, how many of them are regulated and unregulated? And the third one is, what is the most unregulated? Here we can see the number of differentially expressed genes. Here, the total number of upregulated genes and the downregulated ones. Okay. The result match with the expected result. Now, let's check what is the most downregulated gene. Here we can see the first row. Let's copy the gene ID. Okay, it's the same. And in order to evaluate the biological function, we can use the tail database. Now we should paste the gene ID and search. Okay. This one. According to the database, this gene encodes a cytochrome P450 enzyme that catalyzes the LAT reaction in the production of brassinolae. In other words, it's involved in the brassinosteroid biosynthesis pathway. To predict the mRNA targets, first we need the transcriptomic sequence in FASTA format. Then, now we'll obtain the sequence of the microRNA whose expression is induced by brassinosteroids. It will require 4 consecutive steps. First, we'll extract the gene IDs from the upregulated microRNAs. Then we'll filter the transcriptome sequence from the mature microRNA FASTA file and then from the start sequence. Let's start. We should select the column 1 and the file of the upregulated microRNAs and execute. Now we are going to rename the dataset, save. The next step is to get the transcriptome sequence. We should select the mature microRNA FASTA file, list of IDs, select the upregulated microRNA IDs, and execute. And now we should repeat the same, but in that case, we should select the start sequence. Select list of IDs, upregulated microRNA IDs, and execute. And finally, we should combine both files. Okay. Now, let's rename the merged file. You can have a look. You can see it just contains the gene IDs and the filtered files contain both the IDs and the sequence. It contains 9 sequences. Finally, let's rename the merged file Okay. Next, we are going to get the sequence of the downregulating mRNAs, which we'll use to identify potential targets. Again, first we need to extract the identifiers of the downregulated transcripts. Select the column 1, now select the file of the downregulated mRNA and execute. Okay. Now, let's rename the new dataset. Okay. Finally, we'll extract the sequence of the downregulated mRNAs, for which we'll use the complete arabidopsis transcriptome, together with the list of identifiers obtained in the previous step. In this case, it will be necessary to use a regex search pattern. Let's have a look at the transcriptome FASTA file in order to understand the reason. As you can see, the header name includes more information. Let's compare with the microRNA FASTA file. Here, the header line includes only the gene ID. Okay, let's continue. Select the transcriptome FASTA file. Now, list of IDs, non-regulated mRNA IDs, custom regex pattern, and paste the expression, and execute. Now let's rename the dataset. And save. Now we can use the Target Finder tool, which is specially designed to predict potential mRNA targets in plants. It requires two inputs, the upregulated microRNA sequence and the downregulated mRNA sequence. Okay, then let's start. First, select the upregulated microRNA sequence. Now we should select the downregulated mRNA sequence here. We can check the content of each of the files. Now set a prediction score of 5.0 and as output format select tab delimited format and execute. Okay, now let's have a look at the results. Okay, the output of Target Finder includes different columns. The first is identifier of the microRNA, then the identifier of the targets. So you can see we have found 5 different potential targets, then includes additional information such as the score value, the sequence of the target, and the microRNA. Here are the targets. Let's check the biological function of one of them. According with the TIRE database, this gene encodes a low affinity sulfate transporter expressed in the root cap and the setter cylinder. We have identified 5 genes whose expression is potentially downregulated in response to blasting asteroids. In order to confirm the results, we could acquire seeds with mutation in those genes and carry out an experiment under controlled conditions. As additional activity, you can try to repeat the workflow by using the additional dataset that we provide at the end of the training. In that case, we'll compare the gene expression patterns of mutant overexpressing the brassen asteroid receptor BRL3 under 2 experimental conditions, control and drug stress. This exercise can take longer because we provide the original datasets. As a final summary, we have used a combination of different tools for the identification of genes potentially regulated in response to blasting asteroid through a microRNA-mediated mechanism. Here you can find the bibliography that we have used, and we encourage you to leave your impression. Thank you so much for your attention. Bye!